This is Old Spice College Lacrosse on ESPNU. The number one team in the country travels east as Notre Dame puts that ranking and its perfect season on the line against number four Syracuse inside a fired up and raucous Carrier Dome. Welcome to Old Spice College Lacrosse on ESPNU. I'm Eamon McEnany, along with the All-American goalie out of Johns Hopkins, Quint Kesenick. And this is exactly what the Big East had in mind when it went into the lacrosse business. But Quint, no automatic bid for this conference just yet. So what's really at stake between number one and number four on April 30th?
They're definitely playing for a Big East championship. But more important, they're playing for the number one seed in the NCAA tournament. Selection show is on May 8th. The winner of this game is likely to be number one seed. I think the loser will drop somewhere in the number three range. But you see on Monday, the NCAA RPI rankings came out for the first time. This is number one against number two.
Now with a win tonight, the class of 2011 would have the most wins for any class in Syracuse school history. And one of the biggest reasons why, Quint, is the play of the goalie.
And goalie John Galloway is senior. He's an absolute win machine. 52 wins, the most in NCAA history. He's a perfectionist. He's his own toughest critic. He's also a finalist for the Lowe's Senior Class Award. He's a terrific student. This guy is the ideal in terms of a student athlete. Who's going to challenge him for Notre Dame? David Earle, lefty senior midfielder. He's creative. He's impulsive. He's best in creative situations. Dodging in a phone booth, he can do it all. His head coach, Kevin Corrigan, says he's the best all-around midfielder in the nation when he finishes.
He has come alive with six goals in his last three games for number 33 as we take a look at our Warrior Impact players. First, for the visitors from South Bend.
David Earle shoots 22%. His line mate is Zach Brenneman. 6'3", 215. He's a locomotive. Senior year, he's been slowed by injuries. And then goalie John Kemp. He's got a short memory. No soft goals he's given up. He's number two in goals against and save percentage.
And for the 12-1 Syracuse Orange.
Galloway, one of seven Syracuse seniors drafted by Major League Lacrosse. Joel White, electrifying playmaker at the defensive midfielder. And Josh Amadon, another senior. Senior, playing in his 65th game, he can catch and rip it. Great outside shot.
46 career goals for number nine. The third man in our booth is Paul Carcaterra, the former Syracuse All-American midfielder, and he's downstairs standing by with the head coach, John Desco.
Coach, the winner of this game most likely locks up the top seed in the upcoming NCAA tournament. What was the message to your team in the locker room?
Well, you know, that all comes into play, but the first thing we have to do is take care of business against Notre Dame. We got a great crowd here this evening. They play great defense. We got to crack the defense and get one by their goaltender.
It's loud. I'm having a tough time hearing you. Right. Notre Dame brings in the top defense in the nation. How do you plan on attacking this unit?
Well, we're going to try to attack it in different ways. Try to get something off the face-off, off the clears, maybe substitutions. And we have to be patient. We've got to make good decisions against this defense and not be afraid to put it inside once in a while.
Thanks, Coach.
All right, Paul, thank you very much. Notre Dame is coached by Kevin Corrigan in his 23rd season with the Irish. 216 career wins. Still looking for his first win ever against the Orange, 0-4 all time.
Notre Dame is now a national power. Corrigan, tough-minded, great sense of humor, said it's important for our program to be ranked number one.
But not important to this team. Right now they know they want to be number one on Memorial Day, but it is significant for the school and the sport that the Irish are number one. Great atmosphere as always here for lacrosse at the Carrier Dome. It was a beautiful day here in Syracuse. The students are out and fired up, and so is the community. Not very often the number one team is the visitor at the Carrier Dome.
And especially this late in the season.
There's a look at the longtime head man for the Irish. Two of those meetings against Syracuse in the postseason at the 2001 Final Four in Princeton. And then in the quarterfinals up at Ithaca. In 2009. John Desco has the highest winning percentage of any active coach in Division I lacrosse. Looking for his sixth national championship this year. Notre Dame comes into this one with a record of 10-0, the last unbeaten team in Division I lacrosse. Syracuse 12-1, the only defeat here at the Carrier Dome to the hands of Rob Pinnell and the Cornell Big Red as we look back at those four all-time meetings.
Last year's game in South Bend, 12-6 win by Syracuse. They got off to a great start. Notre Dame didn't handle the moment well in the first 10 minutes of that ball game.
Syracuse opened up that game with a 5-0 run in the first, ended it with a 4-0 run in the fourth. Syracuse in the home white, Notre Dame in the road blue. It'll be number 4, the senior Jeremy Thompson, against number 48, Liam O'Connor, the freshman out of Philadelphia for Notre Dame. And we are underway at the Carrier Dome. Thompson wins it himself. And Syracuse will go to work early. Thompson out there with Jovan Miller and Joel White. Being guarded by Earl. Earl takes it away from him and goes the other way. They have Irving as a trailer. Jovan Miller gets back, and Earl puts on the brakes. So great individual defense by David Earl, gives it back to Notre Dame. This is number 45, Max Pfeiffer, the junior out of Virginia, coming off a hat trick against Providence, being guarded by Kevin Drew. He sends it back to Zach Brenneman, the senior All-American candidate, being guarded by Tim Harder. Pfeiffer, Foley has a look, and he sneaks it past Galloway. The Irish go to the attack and take the early lead.
You design an opener play, you practice it all week long, and it works to perfection. Little hiccup off ball for the Syracuse defense, just too much cushion on the wing. And Galloway, cardinal rule of goaltending is stay on that inside post. Foley sneaks it near pipe.
One of the most improved players on the Notre Dame squad, just one goal in 11 games a year ago. Now he has 8 in his sophomore campaign. O'Connor wins it cleanly. Didn't make the first look, but draws the flag. Notre Dame will be going on the extra man as Kevin Drew gets called from behind. So the trend coming in for these two teams.
Push with possession is a time-serving violation off the face-off win. No doubt about that call, setting up our first extra man.
Notre Dame 10 of 31 on the extra man this year, just over 32%. Opponents converting 11 of 50 opportunities against the Syracuse Orange. Parzanese number 9 and Cotter number 11 are your extra man specialists for Notre Dame. This is Brenneman, hands free. Galloway makes the high-to-high save.
On paper, this projects to be a low-scoring game. Notre Dame leads the nation, best defense. Syracuse is 6th. Goals are going to be tough to come by.
Notre Dame allowing under 6 goals a game. Quint, what are your keys for the number 4 Orange?
Got to manufacture goals, whether it be on the extra man, transition, in the substitution game, even garbage. And then they have to defend the Notre Dame midfielders, specifically Zach Brenneman, David Earl, and Max Pfeiffer.
Right now, Brenneman and Cotter for Notre Dame out there have to defend. Normally, offensive specialist Brenneman is covering Amidon. Cotter covering Thompson. This is Tommy Palasek being guarded by Kevin Randall. He is in for Tim Desko. Gets inside, can't put it on cage. Marasco there, but a crease violation or a push. It goes against Palasek, Notre Dame ball.
When you study this Notre Dame defense and you look at their box scores this season, most of the goals being scored against the Fighting Irish have come from attackmen. And midfielders dodge against their defense. They get quick double teams.
Quint, how about your keys for the Irish?
Defend the first 15 seconds of each possession. You go back to that first possession, and Jeremy Thompson took that shot. That's what the Orange likes to do. And their attack has to be productive. They need to get a depth of scoring. Their complimentary guys must show up tonight.
This is number 24, Eric Kepler, junior out of Maryland. Stephen Murphy, number 16, out there with the second group. Cotter is normally with this group, but he's been out there for a while and being shut off by Jovan Miller. This is Foley. He has the game's first goal. Foley going hard. Sends it up top to Murphy. Murphy hands free, can't put it on Cage. Sean Rogers there with the backup. Foley wheeling and dealing, being guarded by Guadagnolo. Tough angle. Again, Rogers there for the backup as Jovan Miller comes off, replaced by number six, Joe Moore. Quint, with this group, how patient is Notre Dame going to be? We've already seen the attack take a quick shot, but with this second midfield group, what do you expect?
I expect ball control to the clock. Give me valuable minutes. Don't mess up. Don't give up any transition off a turnover. You'll see more of an attack presence when this group is in the game.
This is Cotter being guarded by Moore. Sees Joel White coming, wheels and gives it up. Cotter throws it away. An unforced error for the Irish gives it back to Syracuse.
I like the athletes on Notre Dame's second midfield, but the production just not there this year. They have combined for 12 goals between Cotter, Kepler, and Murphy.
Let's go down to Paul Carcaterra down on the field.
Well, Eamon, Notre Dame players mentioned the big stage of the Final Four a season ago, helping them prepare for the Carrier Dome because they are expecting it to be really loud, where every single play is magnified. Senior defender Kevin Ridgeway said, "We always prepare the same for every game, but for this one, there will be probably a little extra edge in the locker room due to the crazy environment. Last year taught us not to get distracted and keep our minds between the lines."
All right, Paul. So far, they've handled the moment well. 5 minutes gone by, and they have a 1-0 lead.
Zach Brenneman said the excitement in practice this week rivaled last year before their Cornell semifinal.
Here's Bobby Eilers running right through the slide, goes behind Maresco. Being guarded by Randall, gets inside, loses his man. Maresco hits a pipe. Eilers, the quick release, can't put it on Cage. Kemp wins the race to the goal, to the ball.
Maresco, left side of your screen, isolating, inside roll, ankle breaking off the near post. You mentioned the crowd here. Acoustically, this is a much tougher challenge than a national final or a national semi when there's 50,000, because all 15,000 here are Orange fans and we're indoors. Communication, a challenge, especially defensively.
So the Irish make the clear. This is Pfeiffer out there with Kepler and Earl.
The last shot by Maresco, a great example of how Notre Dame's defense is not double. They kind of leave their close defenders on an island.
Rogers being guarded by John Lade, the All-American. Here's Brenneman going to work on Moore. Brenneman taking a run at the shorty, hands free, high to high. The Irish take the Hampton Jindy to a 2-0 lead. His eyes lit up when he was guarded by a short stick.
Off a re-dodge, gets to the middle of the field, he gets inside that football hash mark. Right down Sunrise Highway for Brenneman. He is a beast, 6'3", 215.
It's been a roller coaster year for the fifth pick overall, the Long Island Lizards. Had a great opening of the season against Duke with 5 points. Got banged up there, missed a couple of games, and a violation now against Thompson.
The way he was looking over his shoulder at the official.
Irving's got three already, but Drew there to take it away. Irving gets the ground ball back. Now O'Connor The Irish will settle things down with O'Connor and Irving out there. Irving was questionable coming into the game. He missed their last game against Providence. He's missed four of the last five games with a hamstring issue. This is Foley up to Pfeiffer. He's being guarded by Tim Harder. Pfeiffer coming hard, can't put it on Cage.
It's an Notre Dame team that's been handcuffed just a tad by some injuries. Kevin Corrigan has fought through. Guys like David Earl was hurt early in the season, then Brenneman, then Irving.
ESPNU's coverage of Old Spice College lacrosse continues Friday night as two of the nation's top teams face off when number one Notre Dame takes on number 10 North Carolina. Old Spice College lacrosse Friday night at 8 Eastern. In fact, this is the first time all four senior captains have been on the field since the Penn State game. Galloway takes that one. That was the second game of the year back in February. So Galloway now has two saves. And you heard that one in the upper deck. Drew on the clear. He has jets and five goals already. Earl all over him. And he gives it up to Miller. Keogh has been quiet. He's being guarded by Ridgeway. So now Thompson. Looks like David Earl's going to be the 60-minute man tonight for the Irish as he is out there on defense along with Quinn Cully. Now Amidon being guarded by Cully. Amidon's a lefty going down the alley. Gives it up to Keogh. Now Keogh being guarded by the short stick. Keogh looking to create for himself. Not his normal game. Gives it up to Amidon and they switch.
A little too much standing around off the ball.
Amidon gets his hands free. Can't put it on Cage. This is Palasek. Getting the pick and the switch. Now Barnes recovers and Marasco can't hold on to the pass. Amidon had time and room, then Irving closes. Syracuse being patient. They've been forced to be patient this year by zone defenses. Thompson gets a step on Earl, keeps going and beats Kemp. Thompson puts the orange on the board.
Fighting Irish, typically buttoned up on the defensive end. Thompson runs parallel to the hash mark and gets inside. You have two Notre Dame defenders who are responsible for being hot for the double team. Quinn Cully was late. Down low, it looked like Brems was hesitant to slide upfield as well.
Thompson beating his future MLL teammate with the Hamilton Nationals. O'Connor stays on a roll. O'Connor loses it from White. Good hustle by White to get a check on the shot by the freshman out of Philadelphia. So Kepler, Murphy, and Cotter out there once again for the Irish. Feet inside, catch and shoot, Galloway ready for it. The senior's third save of the night puts Syracuse back on offense.
That's a save you make with your feet, your anticipation. You turn faster than that pass and be set and ready when the player catches it. And Foley didn't change levels, made Galloway's job easier than it should have been.
So here is Keogh. This is Steve Ionzito. Scott Loy, now a freshman out of Ohio with the ball. Murphy trying to shut off Joel White.
Joel White not substituting, so they're gonna play this kind of five on five.
Here comes Murphy on the double. Now that Ionzito had time and room, holds on to it. Waits for Bobby Eilers to join the party. Now Sam Barnes goes out on Marasco. Marasco playing with some pep in his step right now. Steve Murphy, number 16, out there on defense. Ionzito coming down the alley, feeds inside. Extra pass. Marasco there. Keo. Now Marasco. Lloyd coming down the alley on Kepler. Sends it behind to Keo. Quick ball movement by Syracuse, but they don't like the looks they're getting. So they back it up as we approach the four-minute mark here in the first quarter. The crowd sensing an important possession even though we're in the opening quarter. Well, Palasek loses his man up top. Feed inside, wide open, Keo!
What a gorgeous goal. Triangle offense. Palasek pushes the corner. Irving 50 and Blue has to step down. Ionzito draws the second double, and Keo is absolutely wide open in front. He had four last year against the Fighting Irish. He's off to a good start. But it starts with Palasek beating his man behind the goal. The defense has to rotate. They get on the carousel, and a great pass by Ionzito.
127 career goals for the senior from Toronto. Ricky Burr, the freshman out of Manhasset, goes out there, and Joel White comes up with the ground ball. O'Connor had won three in a row for the Irish. So now unsettled opportunity for Syracuse. Palasek gets inside, draws a flag, and scores.
We spoke to Kevin Corrigan about this exact type of dive play. Joel White with the tiptoe on the sideline. Is it a dive or is it a push? Looks like a push. The defender on the back of Palasek right here from behind. His initial trajectory was outside the tangent of the crease. Referee's right there to make the call.
Two goals in 16 seconds for the Orange. Quint, one of your keys. Syracuse had to manufacture goals. That's exactly what they did right there.
And when you're attacking this Notre Dame defense, it's going to be tough to score in the half field set. You've got to generate goals in transition. And that was a case where Notre Dame's defense wasn't fully set.
Thompson wins it back and then throws it away. But Galloway has enough real estate to run it down. Let's check in with Paul Carcaterra down on the field.
Well, for Stephen Keough, over the past few games, he feels like he's been getting great looks from guys like JoJo Marasco and Tommy Palasek, but has failed to capitalize at times. He feels teammates need to continue to force feed the ball inside to him. His freshman and sophomore years, players like Mike Lavelle and Kenny Nims had the confidence in him to catch anything in traffic so he could bury the ball. They would throw everything his way, he would say. Number 28 in white wants the ball in his stick early and often after I spoke to him this week.
Kemp makes a save, denying Amidon.
Took that one off the left ribs.
Mark that one down. That was huge for Notre Dame in this juncture right now with Syracuse having all the momentum.
There's been some creased attackmen this year to have nice days against Notre Dame.
Mike Rice for Villanova had a big game, but Notre Dame was able to pull away from the Wildcats. A failed clear by the Irish gives it back to the Orange. ESPNU's coverage of college baseball continues Sunday afternoon with a Big 12 rivalry as number 13 Oklahoma takes on number 5 Texas. College baseball on ESPNU Sunday at 2 Eastern. The good start for Notre Dame is a distant memory at this point, and Kevin Corrigan takes a timeout to talk things over. There's a break in the action at the Carrier Dome. When we return, we'll take a look at the national headlines in college lacrosse. Here at the Carrier Dome, three unanswered goals by the home team has given Syracuse a 3-2 lead on number 1 Notre Dame. Now let's take a look at some of the major headlines in college lacrosse.
RPI released on Monday, Big East domination. Teams 1, 2, 4, and 20. Syracuse, Notre Dame, Villanova, and Georgetown. The league's looking like a 3-bid league into the NCAA tournament. Patriot games. Colgate beats Army and Bucknell beats Lehigh, setting up a Sunday showdown. It'll be Colgate and Bucknell. And the Ivy League tournament set, Cornell will host. They'll play Yale, Penn will play Harvard. Those games will be on Friday.
Here's Thompson being guarded by Taylor Chipuka. Now draws Bobby Smith. And he loses it. Good check by Thompson. Big hit by the former hockey player. McGill comes over, picks up the ground ball. They have to get it back in the box, and McGill still doesn't have possession. Now he does. Unsettled opportunity again. And they never had possession in the box, so it's a turnover. Nice one-on-one defense by Bobby Smith, the junior out of the Jersey Shore.
It's the new rule this year in effect. Offensive team throws the ball past the midline. Once they take that ball over the midfield line, they've got to get it in and keep it in.
Brenneman gets away with a stiff arm on Harder and gets it in the box. Long pass, finds a man open, but Murphy doesn't pull the trigger. Rogers, excuse me, has it, being guarded by Lee. 1:15 to play in the period. Notre Dame scored the first two goals. Syracuse the next three. Now the Irish looking to answer. Earl to his right. Swim technique. Hands free. Too high.
Does everything exceptionally well except shoot.
There is Foley with under a minute to play. Now Pfeiffer. He's guarded by McGill. Feet up top, Brenneman, catch, shoot, save, Galloway. He's got five.
Galloway read that before Brenneman even let it go. Anticipation can be a goalie's best friend. It also can get you burnt.
Near throwaway, now it does come up. Ground ball still loose, no one knows where it is. Igo looking to come up for it. Syracuse still has to get it back in the box. They go back to Galloway. He throws it all the way down. Does he have a touchdown pass? Yes, Marasco. 12 seconds. 10. A goal here, and this place would go nuts. And it will!
There's about 20 seconds to go in the game. Realizes he's up against the clearing clock. Marasco pushing the tempo, force feed inside. Hey, guess what? Maybe Loy wasn't the initial target, but the freshman beats Kemp down low, and this place just erupts.
This quarter can't end fast enough right now for Kevin Corrigan and the Irish, but Burr wins it forward. Dobson picks it up, hit by Harris, and that will do it.
Hey, on that long pass, goalie John Kemp should have come out and made a play on the long pass. He could have come out and delivered a bone-crushing hit or an interception. He was the guy who saw it. He was the guy who had to make a play on that long pass.
The Syracuse crowd rises to appreciate the 4-0 run to end the quarter. The Cuse in control at home after one. Welcome back to the Carrier Dome. Number four doubling up number one after one. We talked about the major college headlines, but right now in college lacrosse, the biggest story is coming out of Charlottesville, Virginia. And for more on that, we check in with Paul Carcaterra.
Well, senior All-American midfielder Shamel Bratton has been dismissed from the Virginia lacrosse team for multiple violations of team rules. Meanwhile, twin brother Ramel Bratton has been suspended indefinitely. This story has been building all season long. Shamel Bratton suspended twice prior to being dismissed, while Ramel Bratton's indefinite suspension comes after being suspended once already. Coach Dom Starzer recently stated that certain standards of behavior are expected of their student athletes and, quote, failure to do so on a consistent basis has resulted in the loss of the privilege of being a member of this team.
All right, Paul, thank you very much. The Cavaliers playing without the Bratton twins today. We're ready to go as they jumped all over Penn, winning that one 11-2. O'Connor keeps it down. Ball squirts out. Earl against White. And that'll be a push against White.
These restarts are dangerous defensively. Check up, call a number. If in doubt, get back in the hole.
So O'Connor comes over, Pfeiffer on. Notre Dame on offense in the first quarter, scored on its first shot, one goal on its last 10. As John Galloway made five saves in that quarter.
You hear the communication, starts with the goalie.
There's Pfeiffer. This is Ryan Foley, a sophomore out of Del Barton. Here's Earl being guarded by Drew. Sees the slide coming. Now back. Gets underneath his man. Big hit. He loses it. Someone's playing without his stick, and it's Earl, and he's hurt. Collapse defense.
Watch the change of direction right there. He suckers the defender into stepping out towards the perimeter, but the help inside.
Here's White. Randall comes out on him. A definite threat to score.
Talking to John Lade this week on my ESPNU podcast, he said, we don't want to slide, but we understand when we have to. And that's a big contrast to the way Notre Dame plays. Notre Dame will slide and double team much quicker.
Syracuse having a lead after one, nothing new. Coming into this ball game, the Orange have outscored their opponents by 21 goals in the opening quarter. While for the Irish, it's the only quarter they're losing by one. Their opponents have scored 19 goals before tonight to 18 for Notre Dame. Now here's Miller. Miller loses Smith back to his right. Kemp stops the high shot for save number two.
Tremendous split dodge. Everything was excellent except the shot location.
Brenneman keeps going and he bounces it and scores. Quint, you were begging him to change levels, and he heard you. End to end for number 28.
Pair of seniors who are both bound for Major League Lacrosse. Jovan Miller, what an amazing split dodge. But a save that is caught is a turnover. Brenneman and Miller, two of the best in the business. Toe-to-toe in the open field, the big man runs by Jovan and buries that ball low and away.
He now has two tonight. You know, Jim Muley, the head coach of the Long Island Lizards, loves seeing that athleticism out of his first-round draft pick. Burr against O'Connor, freshman against freshman. O'Connor comes up with it and goes back to his defense. Liam O'Connor having a big night so far here at the Carrier Dome.
Brenneman slowed middle of the year by an undisclosed injury. Missed two games. Played well when we saw him in Jacksonville in late February. Played an outstanding game against Duke.
Three goals and two assists in the season opener.
Kevin Corrigan told us he feels his senior now back to that form. Scary.
Six goals and two assists coming in. Here's a shot, not on cage, in his last four games. So you can now make that eight goals in his last four and change. This is Foley looking to give it up. McGill all over him. Matchup of New Jersey products. Rogers is going to let Murphy come and get it, but Syracuse beat him to it. John Lade gobbles it up. A turnover for the Irish. Galloway way out of his comfort zone. But Drew there to bail him out. Galloway will take chances. Ian Zito and Gilbert check in. on the offensive end for Syracuse.
Syracuse's best looks offensively have come when the attack initiates from behind.
Here's Lloyd. I think this game is being played at a little quicker pace than many expected, Quint. Ian Zito being guarded by Irvin. Here's Gilbert. Quinn Cully comes out on him. Roy can't make the catch. Kepler can't come up with the ground ball cleanly, but now he has it. And there's a late hit. Free possession for Irving and the Irish. Keogh's going to the box. Now Notre Dame has to keep it in the restraining area. Irving's got three already. Irving going in. Shoots it high.
Green light is on for Andrew Irving. He knows it, so he takes a chance. A smart move by 50. Keogh.
28, 1 minute. Unnecessary roughness.
Picks up a foul white here in the riding situation with just too high and too late. Watch Kepler release this ball, and the ball's way gone. I mean, the rule is basically the same in football. When a quarterback releases the ball, 1,001, man is defenseless, you take him down, an obvious call.
So Notre Dame missed out on its extra man in the first quarter. This one, a minute, so they have a chance to be a little bit more patient. Earl holds on to it, right hand shot, rebound, no, another rebound, no. Who's there? It's Galloway. Galloway with the backup. Parsonese wasn't there in time for the Irish. A flurry of saves by number 15. So now Notre Dame can double the ball on the ride.
What an unusual extra man play. They set a pick and Earl actually dodges. Garbage flurry in front. Galloway closest to the ball when it crosses the end line.
Seven saves for the winningest goalie in the history of Division I men's lacrosse.
He feels like he has something to prove right now. Naysayers coming after him this year. 15th in the nation in save percentage. But save percentage doesn't tell the full story.
Syracuse goalies should be used to that. He's the first Syracuse goalie since 1925 to be an All-American. So the goalies up here don't normally receive credit. Everyone thinks it's the offense.
Save percentage is like rushing yards for a running back. Your save percentage is dependent on your defense. Rushing yards for a running back, dependent on your offensive line.
So Miller out there along with Thompson and Amidon. Keogh back out there after the penalty.
Save percentage does not tell the full story.
Thompson gets it behind. Here's Marasco being guarded by Sam Barnes. Barnes missed all of last year. Thompson looking to line up Bobby Smith. Quinn, it seems that the whole program's looking to prove something. Syracuse, a lot of naysayers, and you look at their record, 12-1 against the toughest schedule in America. People are not impressed by their wins.
Now, they've been the best team in the stadium on 12 of 13 Saturdays.
Palasek looking to create on Earl at goal line extended. Back to his left. Gets inside Earl, loses Earl. Keogh, step down, can't put it in that cage. And Kemp gets the backup.
Taya Keogh just an inch off that corner. Ooh. Syracuse cheated defeat against Georgetown, Johns Hopkins, and Villanova. Not domination with a capital D, but they're winning and they know how to win.
Playing different styles every week, as Coach Desko says. What we see from our opponents isn't what we see on film, as Notre Dame's in trouble here on the clear. He's going to have to get it to Earl, and he does, in stride. Earl gets it in. White goes for the wrap check.
The guys in blue haven't exactly been dominating either at 10-0.
Which is why they didn't get every vote, even though they're the only undefeated team. Johns Hopkins, Cornell receiving some votes for number one. And Kevin Corrigan with 7:34 to play here in the first half. Really wants to tie this ball game up at four, and he wants to talk things over. We'll be back to the Carrier Dome right after this. Welcome back to Syracuse. The Orange have a one-goal lead on Notre Dame. This ball game just part one of a huge night of college lacrosse on ESPNU.
Yo, pals on three. One, two, three. Pals. Throw on the move, catch on the move. Let's go.
I know. Well, you know, Eric, he put his size 93 shoes in front. By then, he can't pass it anymore.
Now's your time to step up. Let's go. We have like 48 hours to figure this out. Hold on. Green. Green. Good. Green. All right. Good job, man. Good job.
Here's the schedule tonight for college lacrosse on ESPNU. After this ball game, the Sector Spiders lacrosse season update show, and that will be followed by All Access inside Bill Tierney's Denver Pioneer program, and then All Access inside the defending national champion Duke Blue Devils. Denver and Duke, two of the best coaches of all time, an inside pass.
Two teachers, two guys who have been ultra successful, two guys who are funny.
Tell that to officials. The cut.
Intense.
Kepler can't hold on to it. Garbage opportunity. Save Galloway. Another save by Galloway. Still loose. Still loose. And it's off McGill. Steve Miller says Notre Dame ball.
Notre Dame now has 18 shots. That's an incredible total. What a stop right there. A little telegraph of the shot. Drop your stick low. Galloway matches up. Goes down to a knee and fills up. He's seeing it right now. He's locked in.
Here's Cotter being guarded. Kepler now by Drew. Kepler working back to his right. Gives it up to Cotter. Murphy being guarded by White. Murphy, the sophomore. Catch and shoot. Got blocked.
Excellent closeout by Thomas Guadagnolo, 42 and White.
Paul, what do you have?
Well, that last time out, Coach Corrigan making it known he wants his team to get up and down and run, was very upset with the attack and their inability to figure out that pass, fast break by David Earl. Off the clear, Earl had definitely numbers and could have started that fast break. Notre Dame attackman not aware, behind the cage. He wants them getting in the right spots, pushing the ball in transition when David Earl has the ball.
Now Murphy being guarded by White. Six on six right now as we approach the 6 minute mark in the second quarter. Cotter, the sophomore out of Washington, D.C. Skip pass, Cotter. Wasn't ready to shoot, so he goes behind. Here's Rogers looking for the wraparound. No dice. McGill and Lade collapse.
The eraser, John Lade. Little trail check as Rogers exposes the stick. Turnover.
Guadagnolo makes the nice catch and takes it over. Gives it up to Palisek. John Desco takes the timeout with 5:25 left to play in the half and a one-goal lead. The Orange with the ball looking to go up two. We're back after this. Starts on May 14th on the field, but before that, the selection show on Sunday, May 8th. We'll let everyone know who's in, who's out, who has home games, and who's going on the road. Then the first round from campus on May 14th and 15th. The quarterfinals from Long Island and Foxborough the next weekend, and then championship weekend from M&T Bank Stadium in Baltimore. As we take a look at the current RPI coming into today's action, the two top teams on the field right now, and then Cornell lurking at number three.
Today was a day defined by teams holding serve. Teams like Cornell and Johns Hopkins. And Virginia, to me, with a statement win, 11-2 over Penn. Is that not the Virginia Cavaliers, the players, saying, hey, this is about us. The distractions are gone. We're going to get our act together.
That was certainly something Virginia needed, struggling down the stretch, not playing well in the ACC tournament, losing to Duke 19-10. And now Virginia all but seals a home game in the first round. The top eight seeds get to play at home in the first round.
I got seven teams I think are really solid, and to me, there's a handful of teams battling for that last eighth slot.
These two teams battling for the top spot. And after a timeout, John Desco sends his second midfield group out there. This is Gilbert. Keeps coming and scoring. The senior gets his second of the year, and it's a two-goal lead once again.
Notre Dame gives up 5.9 goals per game. Look up at the scoreboard. Just not typical Notre Dame defense. Split left to right. Leans in with the body. There's no double there. There's no physicality on defense. Gilbert, veteran player, getting a run there. What a huge goal off the timeout.
Paul Carcaterra, what do you have?
Defensive coordinator Jerry Byrne very upset with that last possession, the Gilbert goal. They scouted them all week. Gilbert, number two in white, a strong right-hander. The Notre Dame defense let him get to his strength. Coach Byrne on the sideline, visibly upset.
And Chris Daddio out there on the faceoff wins it. The freshman out of Virginia breaks the streak of three straight won by the Irish. Notre Dame now leading that category 6-4.
Not sure if the acoustics are leading to some of these breakdowns by Notre Dame. Typically a team that doubles, they show or fake slide adjacent.
Here's Thompson. Nobody picks him up. Now he sees it. Skip pass. Aminon. Back to Thompson. Extra pass. Keogh. Couldn't really get much on that shot. But Marasco there for the backup.
It's a nice play by Brems, 30 and white. As Keogh tried to turn the corner, used his stick to get to the hands of the shooter.
Here's Marasco with under four to play in the half. Being guarded by Kevin Randall. Step down for Jovan Miller. Moves it along to Aminon. Aminon with the swing. Roll all over him. Marasco has Randall caught up. Randall recovers. Aminon on the cut. Catch. No shot. Here's Miller being guarded by Taylor Chipuka. Feet inside. Catch made. Oh my!
Tom Desko told us we want to jam the ball inside to Stephen Keogh. We think that when Notre Dame sets up their double team, he can be open, and the finish is just ridiculous. That's ridiculous. Keogh, please don't try that at home inside.
That will be a top play tonight on SportsCenter, no doubt. And Daddio wins his second straight.
Tell you, get that highlight on I-84 and ship it east to Bristol.
Somebody tell the highlight supervisor you got one from the Carrier Dome. Danger time for the Irish in this one, and Coach Desko wants to talk things over with 2:51 left to play. Last year it was Tim Desko with the goal of the year for Syracuse against Princeton. This one by Keogh will be awfully tough to beat.
Fifty and blue, Irving kind of ball watching and staring. I think Notre Dame's defense was shocked that Miller would jam that ball inside. Keogh can catch anything. And we've seen a variety of finishes from him. Standard, over the shoulder, wraparound. From the book of Tommy Marichek and flashy finishes, Stephen Keogh, a fellow Canadian.
Marichek wearing number 42 here, an All-American in the early 90s. Now, Quint, we were talking earlier this week that when we covered the Notre Dame game against Team USA, Kevin Lavelle had a big game inside, and we're like, well, how many guys in college lacrosse can do what Kevin Lavelle can do?
Stephen Keogh, well, he did it last year. He follows the double man or the slide man so well.
We said he would be an impact player last year. Here it was, 4 goals for then the junior.
Watch how open he is on most of these highlights. Catching inside and finishing from point blank range. From Canada, used to shooting on the small goal, said the key to inside shooting is to get the goalie to move, create an area, and then capitalize. Versatility and the variety of releases. Well, that's something that's generated by the athlete. That's something that Steven has practiced his whole life, to have those options.
128 career goals now for number 28. Let's check in with Paul, who was in the SU huddle.
Syracuse looking for a valued possession. Right now they're going to start in a 2-2-2 offense. Two guys on the crease. Look for them right now to change their formation, to kind of tweak Notre Dame's typical slide package, which comes from the crease. They want Notre Dame to adjust on the fly, change of formation.
This is Loy. He has one already, being guarded by Quinn Cullen. Marasco to Ionzito. Rems on him. Loy and Cully go at it again. Loy draws the slide. Eilers can't make the catch. Rems can't come up with the ground ball. Neither can Smith. Ionzito working hard from the turf. Gets it back to Keogh with 2:09 to play. There's Palasek being guarded by Ridgeway. Now Ionzito. Devin Dobson comes out on him. Feed inside. Catch not made, but Eilers there. Loy, excuse me, what a kick save by Kemp. His third of the ball game was a spectacular one.
And an absolute must-have save if you're a fan of the Fighting Irish. How about the production all of a sudden Syracuse is getting out of this second midfield line, though? Ionzito with an assist earlier. Loy has a goal. Gilbert's gotten in the scoring. Positive signs for the Orange and John Desco.
It's been a long time since the Irish were on offense. They get the ball back with 1:17 to play, out of timeouts here in the half. Nick Beattie, number 3, out there on the attack now, along with Foley and Rogers. White came out for it. Does Earl make him pay? Good recovery by Lade. Brenneman being guarded by a short stick. See if he tries to go get the ball.
No timeouts for either team.
Here's Pfeiffer being guarded by Drew. Good stick check there. Forces another Irish turnover with 43 to play in the half. Drew has jets and he goes by the midfield line with ease. 30 seconds left to play. Here's Keogh. 20 seconds left. Coming up at the half, we'll have the Warrior halftime report. Thompson being guarded by Brenneman. Another big time save by Kemp with 5. Marasco with 4. Irving comes up with the ground ball, and that will do it. The sophomore goalie keeping his key team in this one late in the first half. But other than that, Syracuse carrying the action here at the Carrier Dome.
Severe angle. Kemp elevates, takes a body shot.
Coming up on the Warrior Halftime Report, SportsCenter U with Rob Simulcare, Mark Dixon, and Stephen McElduff with more on the big news out of Virginia, and we'll have a pro session on goaltending. Now let's go down to Paul with Coach Corrigan.
Coach, you let up under 6 goals a game in the regular season. This unit on offense for Syracuse has that total already. How do you slow this group down?
Paul, we missed a couple things defensively, some easy slides that we should have shown to. And we didn't can some of our opportunities to keep the momentum, you know, from kind of going their way. You know, I'm not worried about what we average. This is tonight's game. We got to make plays tonight. That's what this is about.
Offensively, you've had some turnovers, especially on the extra man. What type of adjustments do you make on that end of the field?
I'm not worried about that either. We had, how many layups get blocked? Three, four? It's a good game. They're going to make plays. We're going to make plays. We got to finish our plays, and we got to make a couple adjustments down there defensively, just to, and showing a little bit more aggressively to some things. We're going to be fine.
Thanks, Coach.
Our score at the half, number 4, Syracuse 6, number 1, Notre Dame 3. Coming up, the Warrior Halftime Report. We'll check in with the studio for a look ahead to the postseason. All that and more coming up after the break. Welcome back to the Warrior Halftime Report. The first 30 minutes of action between number 1 and number 4 are in the books here at the Carrier Dome. Now, in tonight's Warrior Pro Session, Quint Kesenick and Jesse Schwartzman discuss the finer points of goaltending.
This halftime report is presented by Warrior. All hail. And now, a Warrior Pro Session with Quint Kesenick.
The lacrosse goal is big, the ball is small, and moves at speeds up to 100 miles per hour. The goaltending position in lacrosse, one of the toughest in sports. Requiring cat-like quickness and guts, goalies are a different breed. They stick their bodies in front of projectiles when most mortals would duck for cover. Hand-eye coordination and solid angle play are mandatory traits. When the game is on the line, the best goalies are poised and ready to make a difference. We are joined by Jesse Schwartzman, professional goalie, former two-time NCAA champion, who has the ability to make the game-changing save, the one from point-blank range. How do you do it?
Well, first, I got to focus on the shooter's stick. That's where the ball is. That's where it's going to come out. He's going to try and throw me off by faking and all that, so I got to stay focused and patient in the goal. And the third thing, when the ball leaves the stick, I got to react and just throw my body at the ball.
Okay, I get the question a lot. I'm sure you do, too. What is the toughest shot for you to save?
Well, it's kind of different. It depends where it's coming from, who's shooting it. But in all, I think the toughest shot to save is the offside hit. I mean, first of all, you're standing in the cage, and to get to the offside hit, you either have to go all the way over top or come all the way underneath, and that's just a far movement and tough to make that save.
For you, what was the toughest transition from the college ranks at Johns Hopkins now to Major League Lacrosse?
Well, Johns Hopkins, everyone was good, but we were playing in a system. Now in the pro league as a goalie, every person's a threat. You have to worry about 6 guys on the field that are all shooting 90 miles an hour plus, and the whole speed of the game. There's a shot clock, so the kind of focus has to be there at all times.
What is the toughest aspect of goaltending in the professional ranks?
Guarding the two-point range and guarding the fast shot. There's a number of guys that can bring the ball 100 miles an hour plus, so I guess just being courageous in the goal is a big thing.
It takes a lot. It takes technique, smarts, focus, and courage if you want to be a successful goalie in lacrosse.
Welcome back to Old Spice College Lacrosse. For only the second time all year, number 1 Notre Dame is trailing at the half. The Irish were able to come back against St. John's. It'll be a little bit different on the road against number 4 Syracuse. Welcome back to the Carrier Dome. Eamon McEnany along with the All-American goalie out of Johns Hopkins, Quint Kesenick. And Quint, the Syracuse seniors can make history tonight, and they played like it in the first half.
You know, that's what you expect from the Syracuse team. They've won 2 national titles. They've danced every big dance, and in a big game, you expected them to play their best, and they've done that so far tonight.
4 of the 6 goals in John Galloway spectacular as we take a look at our first half highlights.
Notre Dame got off the bus and were ready to play tonight. Zach Brenneman scores left-handed. 2-0 they led. But Syracuse took over 4 straight. Keo from Ionzito, a great pass. And then Joel White with the grounder. One of the keys to this game was Syracuse scoring early in possessions. And here's Palasek, pushes the crease, makes it 3-2 Orange. Brenneman stuffed by Galloway. The senior's got 8 stops. Brilliant save low. He has been dominating. Brenneman, the lone star for Notre Dame. Irish have only scored 1 goal in the last 22 minutes. That made it 4-3. Jovan Miller to Keo. Are you kidding me? 6-3 Syracuse leads. They are shooting 38%. Notre Dame only shooting 16%.
Before the second half faceoff, let's check in with Paul Carcaterra.
Had a chance to connect with Coach Desco coming out of the tunnel. He feels his midfielders need to step up. He thinks that Notre Dame defense is kind of sloughing from the midfield, needs penetration from that unit in the second half. And Coach Leland Rogers, defensive coordinator for Syracuse, plans on continuing to deny Zach Brenneman, 28 in blue, the ball with a short stick. Tim Harder has that assignment. Did a nice job in the second quarter. Plans to keep that going in the third.
All right, Paul, Joel White does what Joel White does. Pick up a ground ball as he continues to move up the all-time list here at Syracuse. He will mostly be the school's leader in that category when his career's over. Here's Thompson being guarded by Earl. Gets inside, no one picks him up, but he can't put it on Cage.
Not sure if this Notre Dame defense is respecting these Syracuse Dodgers, because typically they would get a double team and a quick slide, whether it be adjacent or from the crease, as you look at some of the stats on the bottom of the screen. And Kevin Corrigan referenced it before halftime. He said, we need to show better. And what that is when the adjacent man steps up as if to slide in a posture like I'm ready to go. And that can be a deterrent to dodge.
Miller with the swim sends it back up to Thompson, who loses it. Unable to get it back. Barnes neither. Still loose. Thompson thought about pulling the trigger quickly on the unsettled. Keough now being guarded by Irving.
Syracuse has been the better team off the ground. Contested ground balls. The guys in white seem to have more bodies in the scrum.
Here's Marasco from up top. Played last year as a midfielder. Ridgeway pushes him back. Thompson, catch. Good check on the ground ball. The Palisek there. That's going to be a hold on Miller off the ball. Andrew Irving looking for a quick start. Steve Miller says, get right back here. So now Kevin Corrigan's club will have to clear it against the settled defense. The pass to Pfeiffer. Catch made. Drew on him. Been a while since Notre Dame scored. As Quint mentioned, they ended the first half in a drought of 22 minutes and 36 seconds. Earl gets a pick from Brenneman. Two-man game. Brenneman, time, room, too high. Living dangerously, giving Zach Brenneman that look. Here's Foley. Foley. Galloway with an easy save.
Feeding the monster. Start up the third quarter with an easy save. Give that goalie, the senior goalie, all the confidence. We start the first save of the game and the first save of the third quarter with the most difficult to make.
He now has 9 saves. One away from another double-digit effort. Earlier this year, he made 16 against Duke. 13 in the overtime win against Georgetown. Coaches call out JoJo Urimitti. So number 22, JoJo Marasco, will go up top. This is Bobby Eilers giving it up to Keough. So Harder out there, 32, normally a defensive specialist. They're going to try to get him off the field. Ian Zito taking a run at Earl. Telegraph slide, two-man game. Palisek with the finish.
Zito may be the most improved member of this Syracuse team. Dodges strong right-handed, draws the double, kicks it backside. Palisek, one touch on the backside. Great look by Ian Zito, who dusted David Earl, who's a very good defensive midfielder.
Ian Zito, a local product, played his high school ball at Cicero North Syracuse. Daddio with a clean win.
Zito now with 2 assists.
Gave him 6 points on the season. That second group earlier this season was MIA for Coach Desko, and he wasn't afraid to say that publicly. He was challenging that group to come up and make contributions. Now he's very happy with it.
All
No team this year has scored 10 goals against Notre Dame. Denver got to 9, Villanova got to 8. Thompson keeps going. Syracuse is rolling right now.
That's the exact play that Kevin Corrigan referenced in his interview with Paul Carcaterra before halftime. Syracuse takes the crease up high, which leaves that defender on an island. The double gets there, but it's too late. And if you can get to that football hash marks, you've gotten to the paint, so to speak, in the sport of lacrosse. Thompson perking up today. He's got a pair of goals.
15 on the season, another clean win by the freshman Daddio. White goes back and pads his ground ball stats.
Okay, too often Notre Dame defenders playing straight-legged defense. They're not getting down low and cross-checking at the hips. They're up around the shoulders.
Coming into this ball game, Joel White had 264 career ground balls, 15 away from the all-time leader, Jarrett Park. He's having a big night once again in that department.
15 away. He's got a shot to get there.
Got a shot. He has 18 in his last two games, including a career-high 10 against Hobart. He had 8 last week against Rutgers. Thompson feeling it. Does Marasco now join the party, being guarded by the short stick? Not on Cage. Amadon being guarded by Trapuca. Amadon keeps coming. Still has it. Fake. Draws the slide. Can't put it on Cage. Halasek there for the backup with an even 10 minutes left to play in the third quarter. Marasco back up top with Barnes on it. Back to his right. Shot. ESPNU's coverage of the college lacrosse postseason gets started on Sunday, May 8th at noon Eastern with the Ivy League Championship. ESPN is your home for the 2011 NCAA Men's Lacrosse Championship. The Ivy League tournament will be held at Schoelkopf Field in Ithaca on the campus of Cornell. As we take a look at the bracket, Cornell wins the regular season to host. They'll take on Yale and then Harvard and Penn. How many teams come out of the Ivy League for the field of 16? And can Cornell work its way up to the top seed? Cornell, the only team to knock off Syracuse this year. Marasco gives it up. Halasek goes right at Brems, gets underneath them. Good slide and collapse. And Smith comes up with a ground ball. He's double teamed. Now Keogh. Not a very popular call by Steve Miller.
Loose ball push.
Notre Dame with just one shot in the last 13 minutes needs to get something going offensively with 9 minutes left to play in the third. Here's Westy Hopkins. He's been quiet. The Irish 0 for their last 9 shots. They send the second midfield group out there with Cotter, Murphy, and Kepler. Kepler being guarded by Moore. Gets it behind to Rogers. Now Hopkins. McGill laying the lumber. Hopkins gets inside and finishes. The freshman from Philly ends the drought.
Westy Hopkins took a PG year, so when he showed up on campus in South Bend, he was ready to go. the brightest of the Irish freshmen, his 11th goal of the season, inside roll, not much angle. But if there's one thing he has shown the ability, that's to finish the ball. A high shooting percentage, above 36% in his freshman campaign. Really surprised we didn't see more of him in the first half.
Did that postgraduate year at the Lawrenceville School in New Jersey. Had a hat trick against Villanova. Zero goals in the next three games. That drought is over as well. Daddio wins it forward, but two forward, creating a scrum. Smith there for Notre Dame. Dobson can't come up with it. Someone came out of the box, and it was Syracuse.
Keogh's a walking infraction in this game.
Hey, when you score that goal, they'll look the other way, right? When you have two, and one of them's a highlight reel one. But it's a possession for the Irish now, down by four. Again, they go back to the second group, Kepler and Cotter.
That's an interesting call.
Now Murphy.
You expect off that goal in the faceoff win to see the number one group.
There's Kepler being guarded by Harder. Guadagnolo ready on the slide. Lade picks it off, the All-American. His former coach, Mike Corrado at Villanova, told me this week, you watch, he will pick off two or three passes at goal line extended. The coach had a pretty dead-on scouting report.
Ankle injury cost John Lade two games plus. Back to 100%. Wasn't healthy enough to cover Rob Pennell. Cornell's lopsided victory against Syracuse. Those two teams meet in the playoffs, and Lade is healthy. That's a matchup that I'd pay twice the ticket value to get into M&T Bank Stadium to watch Lade and Rob Pennell.
The executives might hear you, Quentin. Won't pay you. They'll make you pay a ticket. Buy a ticket. Here's Loy off the substitution. Irving out on him. Lade suffering that high ankle sprain injury against Duke at the Big City Classic. Barnes goes down on the collision with Keogh. Now Keogh has it back. There's Marasco being guarded by Barnes. Keogh on the run. Tough angle. Kemp makes the save. Rebound. No. Kemp with his fifth save of the night as we check in with Paul Carcaterra.
Well, Eamon, injury or not, John Lade a lock to become a first-team All-American for a second straight season. He mentioned his style of play is laid back. He's not a defender who's going to try to take the ball away. His focus is on making sure his attackman does not get a good option to shoot or pass. He watches film on the other team's offense and who he's covering. Tendencies is his focus. Not a bad career for a player who wasn't recruited because of his size.
When Cully in trouble, and it doesn't matter. The Irish with another failed clear, taking too much time. The substitution cost them. And now an unsettled opportunity for Islers in the Cuse.
I knew it was a big game here when Mike Morrison, Syracuse's sports information director, said, yeah, I'll get you a guy for your podcast, John Lade, because Lade is like a clam. You cannot get that kid to crack. And you know it's a big game. Lade is intense. You watch him practice. Unbelievable work ethic, intensity on every drill. High standards, as Paul said, kind of like an enlisted man. He's a four-star general in lacrosse right now. A real meat and potatoes guy, a foot soldier.
Rock solid, in the words of an opposing coach. He knows his angles. He knows his strengths. Under 5 minutes to play here in the third. Syracuse with the ball back and a four-goal lead. Aminon to Thompson. Ridgeway back out there on Miller. He's not normally up top, Ridgeway. Now Miller takes him to the crease. Here's Thompson being guarded by Kepler. Loses his footing. Marasco has it. Barnes on him. Double. Somebody's open. Can Marasco find him? Catch. Man. Load it. Oh, there's a goal. Keogh's got another one.
Talked about release points earlier on in the show. Low release to a high shot location. Goalie dips down, drops his stick. all sorts of cage. That angle shows it. Look at Kemp drop his stick. Deception. You change levels.
He is our Sector Spiders player portfolio. He's been doing that the minute he stepped on campus 4 years ago. 129 career goals, now 21 career hat tricks. O'Connor wins a faceoff cleanly. Gives it up. Hopkins thought about it. Gets it to Dobson. So now the Irish will regroup and get some offensive personnel out there. Hopkins being guarded by a short stick. Daddio. White comes to help him. We heard Leland Rogers say, get off, get off. Earl loses his man, Drew. Back to the right. No catch made. Turnover number 10 on the night for the number one team in the country. Number one and undefeated Notre Dame on the road against number four Syracuse. The Orange in control here at the Carrier Dome with a 5-goal lead. Eamon McEnany along with Quint Kesenick. Paul Carcaterra is down on the field. These are the two top two teams in the RPI right now in Division I men's college lacrosse. The bracket comes out next Sunday night. Most likely the winner in this ball game will be the top seed in this year's tournament. Here's Palasek being guarded by Barnes. Now Randall on the switch with under three to play. 9 goals matches the most given up by the Notre Dame defense. That was by Denver in a 1-goal Notre Dame win. Here's Ian Zito being guarded by Earl. Irving comes on the slide. Extra pass, time, room. Saved by the pipe. Kemp finally recovers it.
Snappy offense by Syracuse. Ian Zito drawing the double team. Kicks it back up top. They get the nice ball reversal.
Coach Desko said this week to the local media, hopefully the difference will be the Carrier Dome, and there's no doubt this team is feeding off this crowd as Earl gets underneath and scores.
It's a carbon copy of a goal he scored last year in the playoffs against Princeton. Goal line extended, little change of direction, severe angle.
David Earl, if you look at his ability to get underneath players, that's the hockey background. They call it a skinny at Notre Dame. Coach Byrne talks about it a lot. David Earl is so smooth at getting underneath his defenseman and extends higher to continue his angle with a great shot.
Earl, a standout hockey player at the Westminster School in Simsbury, Connecticut. For the most of his high school career, thought he was going to play D1 hockey. His coach at the high school level, his dad, Tommy Earl, a former Hartford Whaler.
One of our Warrior Pro sessions earlier this season, we talked about that wing dodge, where as an offensive player, if I step away from the goal, back up, my defender then steps at me, that's a good time to go to the goal when you have two bodies moving in different directions.
Here's Cotter. As O'Connor off the faceoff violation now comes off, it's Cotter, Kepler, and Murphy. Notre Dame tries to creep back in this ball game. Hopkins on McGill. Dangerous pass recovered by Colin Igo. Loses it to Guadagnolo. Clean takeaway. Guadagnolo can't keep it in. The Irish get it back with 1:21 to play. Here's Kepler being guarded by Joe Moore. Now Murphy, White on him. Murphy, time, room, jump shot. Who's got the backup? It's Hopkins. 1:05 to play in the third. Hopkins quickly attacking, gets a step, wrong side of the net. Rogers there with it.
What a save by Galloway. And we're going the other way. Drew can fly. 10 saves for Galloway. Unsettled. Drew pulls up. Coach Corrigan said it at halftime. How many layups have we not cashed in on? There's another one.
Left side of your screen, point blank range. That's a shot that Stephen Keel of Syracuse has been burying all night. No such luck for Notre Dame.
The Orange with an opportunity to really work this crowd into a frenzy as they rise to their feet and chant, "Let's go, Orange." Amidon can't put it on Cage. 12 seconds left in the quarter. Taylor Chapuka running out there now with 10. Here's Palasek being guarded by Barnes with 9. Palasek gets a step, gets the goal line extended, can't put it on Cage with 4.3 seconds left when they blow the whistle. Three seconds left. Keo will throw it into the middle of the field and hope to find a teammate for the quick release. Here's the pass. Joel White makes the catch, but he does not get it off in time. So the largest crowd of the season likes what they see so far. Number 4 is up by 4, the fourth quarter from the Dome when we return. So the season. The Fighting Irish moving closer to the edge of loss number 1 of the season as we take a look at tonight's Old Spice game track. John Galloway with double-digit saves. Stephen Keough with career hat trick number 21. The Orange up by 4.
Syracuse shooting 33%. Notre Dame only 19%.
Faceoffs even. Daddio wins it forward again, but there's Irving for Notre Dame. Irving comes up with it cleanly, about to get double. Drew all over him. He's in trouble, and he throws it up. And Foley bails him out. A rare unsettled opportunity for the Irish. Galloway now coming out of the crease. So now they'll settle down and get the offensive personnel they want out there as Irving and O'Connor will come up. Irving playing the substitution game. So is O'Connor. They give it up to Pfeiffer being guarded by Harder. Just under 15,000 people here at the Carrier Dome as we send it down to Paul Carcaterra.
Notre Dame huddle with Kevin Corrigan, very upbeat. He told his team, don't panic. 4 goals is not a big deal. He wants them to tighten up defensively, though. When they slide, they have to replace. It's the second slide he's more concerned about when this Orange offense gets going. Coach Burns said, challenge every player on Syracuse.
And Randall comes out to challenge White, and White gives it up to Drew. Colin Donahue, number 17, out there on attack. He has the ball right now. Here's Palasek.
Syracuse has shown the ability this year to play at 2 speeds. A game like Johns Hopkins or Georgetown, slow tempo game. Virginia was an up-tempo game. Right now, I think they'll slow this game down a little. 4-goal lead.
Kia rolls it out to Miller. Pfeiffer comes out to guard Miller. Amidon. Smith closes out on him. Miller with Earl on him. Yard sale at the Carrier Dome. Earl comes up with it. What a takeaway by the senior. Miller wants it back. Earl going through 3 guys. Make it 4. The pass can't connect. So the great defensive effort results in another turnover for the Irish, number 11.
Ball was out of the stick. If it had remained in Jovan Miller's stick, that would have been a whistle.
David Earl showing tonight why the Hamilton Nationals can't wait for him to become a professional at Major League Lacrosse.
Kevin Corrigan, his head coach, said he's the best all-around midfielder in Division I lacrosse when he's finishing the ball. plays defense, runs the field. He'll be a better pro. He'll get more production in Major League Lacrosse than he gets at the college level because of the style of play.
Allison being guarded by Ridgeway. Now Donahue. Coach Desko looking for a call on Devin Dobson all over Miller.
Cross-checking.
Desko really selling it.
Again, his hands are spread.
Here's Thompson being guarded by Taylor Chipuka. Kent made a save, heard some metal too, but right now Brems has it in the open field. Brems looking for some help. And it's Rogers. Amidon not giving up on the play. Not letting him get in the box. Rogers looking for somebody, can't find anybody. Another turnover, number 12, as the Irish just can't make the clear.
Terrific play by Amidon, who is a very underrated defender. And then McGill stretches adjacent, denies his man the opportunity to catch easily.
Some of these players out there right now have to be gassed. As Ian Zito checks in, now Thompson will come off. Notre Dame's going to have a few tired defenders out there. Ian Zito and Eilers right now. Here comes Marasco. So Marasco could have a favorable matchup right now, being guarded by Devin Dobson. 22 on 22. Keough going right by Brems and finishes for the second straight year. Keough has 4 against Notre Dame, and Syracuse has 10.
Goal of the year. Not thought as a Dodger. Keough likes his matchup. How about the location? Offside hip. Keough is deceptively strong in everything he does, whether it's ground ball play, contact. The trail check was there, Eamon, but he actually just shot through the trail check. He's a powerful, powerful force.
O'Connor pops it forward, comes up with it. They're quick to slide, and Joel White picks off the pass. Turnover number 13. Notre Dame's not giving itself a chance right now. Drew in the open field. Over to White. ...14,751 fans, almost all of them wearing orange. Pick up the volume. The fourth largest regular season crowd in Carrier Dome history. It was also the largest on-campus crowd in Division I lacrosse this season. Eilers looking to lose Kepler.
You are worried about it being such a nice day up here.
The students were out today enjoying the sun, no doubt about it.
62 degrees. Sunscreen sales through the roof. I've never seen anything like it. Hats, mittens, bathing suits.
Marasco being guarded by Kepler. Feed inside. This time a rare misconnect. Ian Zito there for the ground ball, though, as we approach the 9-minute mark.
The orange loss to Cornell. John Desko said refocus. And I think we've seen the results of that refocus tonight.
Marasco gets above, shot blocked. No, it didn't, it went in.
It's a mismatch. Anytime Marasco gets a short stick defender, not sure Kemp ever saw it, because when Marasco took that shot, he put it right off the hip of the defender. So tough for the goalie to spot the ball in the pocket. Judging by the way Kemp didn't really react, don't think he ever got a keen eye to that ball.
Sounded like it was blocked. Must have went in off the pipe. Face-off violation. So the Irish get possession. Down by six. Here's Pfeiffer. Brenneman now out there. Pfeiffer takes a run at Drew. Keeps coming, gets it behind. Laid with a clean takeaway. The All-American struts his stuff. The Eraser is back in business for Syracuse.
Watch the poke when the stick comes in front. Not a complicated check. When that offensive player face dodges or split dodges, and stick comes in front, it's a great time to poke check.
14 turnovers for Notre Dame. Here's White being guarded by Brenneman. Quint, you mentioned the loss to Cornell and refocusing. Coach Desko almost thinking that might have been a positive. Miller, because last year they went to the postseason on such a roll, maybe they didn't understand the immediacy of one and done.
Yeah, I pity the team that has to come here to play the Orange in that first round game. Because after what happened last year, I don't like the chances.
Thompson, what a stunner that was. Keogh now. Extra pass, but Miller can't hold on. It was tipped by Ridgeway, so Syracuse will hold on to it.
How about Army? The team that pulled off that upset last year. They're on their final lifeline.
The ESPNU's coverage of Old Spice College Lacrosse continues Friday night as two of the nation's top teams face off when number one Notre Dame takes on number 10 North Carolina. Old Spice College Lacrosse Friday night at 8 Eastern from Chapel Hill, North Carolina. You know Notre Dame, if this doesn't change here, will not want to go in to the postseason on a two-game losing streak. North Carolina head coach Joe Bresci on hand here tonight, scouting the Irish. The Heels losing in the first round of the ACC tournament, blowing a big fourth-quarter lead to Maryland as we take a look at the Tar Heels' resume. To make the field or get a home game, North Carolina is a swing team right now with 1 week left to play. There's a stall warning, our first of the night. So much talk about the pace of play going into this one. With 6 minutes left in the fourth quarter, we get our first stall warning, and it's on Syracuse. Thompson. Trying to sell the hold on Smith. Miller. Lining up Trepuka from behind on the invert. Normally the midfielders come from up top. Miller gives it up to Marasco. Marasco gets a step on Ridgeway. The wraparound denied by Kemp, but Ridgeway's going to the box. Keogh's shot off the mark, but it'll be an extra man opportunity as JoJo Marasco went hard to the goal against Kevin Corrigan's defense.
One hand wraparound shot.
You hear the officials, they still have to keep it in, so the stall warning still in effect.
The warning carries over, and it's this happened when Syracuse played Princeton, and it's something that John Desko wants the rules committee to address.
First extra man opportunity for the team with a 6-goal lead. Randall comes out on Palisade. If Syracuse needs to improve in one area heading into the postseason, this is it, as Pete Coleman tiptoes the restraining line. Here's Thompson over to Keough. Penalty's released. Marasco fires. Kemp didn't know where that one was. Ninth save of the night for the sophomore out of Georgetown Prep.
49th ranked Syracuse extra man in the nation.
Earl open in the middle of the field. Here comes White. Catch made. Shot. Score. Rogers.
Tell you, you watch tape of Notre Dame, and Sean Rogers has a quick release in transition. Feet are set and ready to go. Passes on the money. One cradle, a hop step, and boom, that ball is gone. Efficiency in motion.
The junior out of New Hyde Park, New York on Long Island has now scored in every game but the Penn State win back in February. Burrow wins it forward, can't come up with it. Irving there for the Irish, no one there to help him out. He flings it back, Pacquiao there. Now Barnes has O'Connor in the middle of the field. Look out. O'Connor holds on to it. Gets it to Dobson. Syracuse left on the schedule, a regular season game here next week against St. John's. Notre Dame here on ESPNU at Chapel Hill. Cornell has the Ivy League tournament. What does a win here tonight for Syracuse, if it doesn't change point, mean for the postseason?
May starts in 3+ hours. The Orange are serving notice. They are the team to beat.
Rogers gets underneath. Good recovery by Lane, and there's a crease violation. That's why they call him the Eraser.
Talk all you want about Cornell.
Wait, that's all you've been talking about the last 2 weeks.
But if John Lade is in the lineup, it's a totally different ball game. I love Cornell. Offense number one in the nation right now. You spoke to Bill Tierney of Denver this week. He had only compliments from what he's seeing. Gotta love the way the Big Red's playing.
Squeaking by Princeton today.
But this senior class here, 7 seniors drafted by Major League Lacrosse, 2 rings.
Under 3 minutes away from 58 career wins for this class, which will make them the winningest class in school history. The class of 1986 won 57 games. To put it in perspective, though, some of those great teams in the late 80s and 90s played less games. The Gates and Matt Palin. A couple of perfect seasons there for the Syracuse Orange back in the day, but still. A very impressive 4-year run for this group. Here for Coach Desco.
I think the bigger question is, where does this leave Notre Dame?
Well, their strength of schedule obviously isn't going to drop when you play the number 4 team in the country.
We get to see him on Friday night against North Carolina.
More postseason conversation coming up is what a fastball by Earl. David Earl is not going quietly.
Slowed by an early season lower back injury. Sniffing it out on the wing. Too much cushion.
Earl with 3 points tonight. Now has 12 in his last 4 ball games. He really came alive in the postseason last year. 5. O'Connor gives it up. Here's Hopkins with under 2 to play. They got to go quickly. Draws the double. Save. Rebound. O'Connor can't pick it up cleanly. Now he does, and he gets the push ball. Did they get the timeout before the call? They did. So Notre Dame will hold on to it with 1:39 to play.
And
We'll be back to the Carrier Dome right after this. The Orange up by four. The number one team on the country of the country is on the brink of loss number one, thanks in large part to the play of Syracuse's senior goalie John Galloway with 12 saves.
See the dirt he wears on his cheeks from his high school field nearby Camillus, New York, West Genesee. He was on top of this game, especially early, holding Notre Dame to only one goal for 22 minutes of the first and second quarters.
Ready to pick up career win number 53, already the all-time winningest goalie in NCAA history.
That's not eye black, that's actually mud.
Pfeiffer going quickly. Somebody got a piece of that one. Now Foley with 126. Brenneman being guarded by Guadagnolo. Brenneman hands free, shot on the run. Oh my, that one was cooking with gas.
Brenneman's got a hat trick, Earl's got two. It's the other guys that have to produce. Nobody is making that stop, whether in college or professional. Brenneman on the run, the big man.
1:19 to play. O'Connor. Daddio wins it forward and cleanly, but loses it. Earl comes up with it momentarily. Joel White. Oh, what a helicopter by Irving. Who's going to come up with this ground ball? The Irish unsettled. Takeaway by Guadagnolo. White wants revenge. Through too much traffic, but Kevin Corrigan got the whistle. The 14,000 plus didn't hear it, but luckily for Coach Corrigan, Steve Miller did.
That was an unbelievable flurry. That was awesome. From the faceoff to the intense ground ball play.
Andrew Irving.
Watch this. White in traffic. Boom.
Whoa. Says, so you're the best long stick midfielder in America?
And then Irving almost loses his head. Great check by
Earl
Drew.
Earl loses his stick.
Here comes Joel White. Great wrap check by Guadagnolo. Re-enter Joel White. Always hustling.
And there's the timeout call. You see the official put his hand up. Look at that. Helicopter high above Syracuse, traffic on Irving Avenue.
Flea market on Marshall Street on Sunday.
Talk to the front office of the Denver Outlaws. They love Andrew Irving. They say his motor never stops.
If it goes your way, you come hard to the middle, and Dave will be over there. If you don't have it, and we attack that side, okay?
Let's go.
Hey, your blue shot. Okay, here we go. One, two, three.
Fire.
Let's go.
Go.
Let's check in with Paul Carcaterra down on the field.
Well, in terms of John Galloway, a lot of people look at SU's goalie, his statistics, and question the type of year he's having. He admitted this season's been different for him. Some teams only willing to take 10 to 15 shots on cage per game. Galloway recently told me, I'm not seeing too many alley shots. Don't get me wrong, I'm not complaining, but sometimes people only talk about numbers and it gets to you.
So Drew had a takeaway on Pfeiffer. Pfeiffer gets it back. Can't put it on cage. 40 seconds left in the ball game. Foley to Hopkins. They got to go. Laid all over him. Laid with another cause turnover. White with another ground ball. And the fans stay on their feet here at the Carrier Dome. No call, it's a turnover. Notre Dame gets it back. Coach Desco says he was calling for a timeout. And the officials give it to him. Now they're wiping it off. He gets it back. With 20 seconds left.
Whose ball is it?
They got to say they gave him the timeout before Joel White went out of bounds. So it'll be Syracuse's ball.
You can't call a retroactive timeout.
Coach Desko this week saying hopefully the difference will be the Carrier Dome, the largest on-campus crowd this season. Certainly played a role, but more importantly was the role played by his seniors.
Make sure we get back.
Not very often the Orange are the quote-unquote underdogs.
Lower-ranked team.
Lower-ranked team.
But when Coach Desko looks at the box score tonight, he'll see double-digit saves from his senior goalie, four from his senior attackman from Canada, Joel White all over the place, caused turnovers and ground balls by Lade.
Seniors win in May.
Joel White with five ground balls, giving him 269 for his career. So he does not pass Rick Beardsley tonight. That will probably happen next week against the Red Storm, as Marasco will try to run out the final 20 seconds. Barnes on him. Six, five. Notre Dame is undefeated no more. The Orange flex their muscles at home and win it 11-8. For the fifth time this year, Syracuse defeats a top 10 opponent to improve to 13-1. The winningest senior class in history is now the class of 2011 for Syracuse University. That is saying a lot in college lacrosse. And when you have four against the number one team in the country, you're going to have a big smile. The Irish need to regroup as they go back on the road next week for a tough one against North Carolina.
For Stephen Keough and Syracuse, after dropping that Tuesday game to Cornell, wow, refocused, improved, best performance of the year. Conversely, there's Notre Dame. Good news for them, they get a chance to play a quality opponent before the tournament starts next Friday night.
Let's send it down to Paul Carcaterra, who's standing by with the winningest goalie in Division I lacrosse.
Well, John, your senior class now becomes the winningest class in Syracuse history. What did this win tonight mean for the program and your class?
It's pretty unbelievable accomplishment. I think we'll be able to look at it back, you know, after we graduate, years after, we'll be able to kick back and cherish these moments. But right now, we're just excited to get a good win against a very good team. And, you know, we have a good chance of seeing these guys on the road. But right now, we just have to prepare for St. John's in the playoffs.
What did you think about your defense in terms of giving you those shots that you could see, 12 saves on the night? I thought you were fabulous.
You know, they gave me great angle shots, really low angle shots, great opportunity to see the ball. And, you know, the shots that I let up in the fourth quarter, I got to make those saves to put the game away. So a little frustrating at the end of the game, but we were able to put a great defensive effort in against a very talented Notre Dame team.
We're only a few hours away from May. Last May, you guys were upset by Army. How does that experience come into play heading into this playoff?
We have a bitter taste in our mouth when it comes to May, and, you know, we're fired up. We got a chip on our shoulder, but right now all we can worry about is St. John's and taking the Big East championship and then get prepared for playoffs.
Thanks, John.
The Orange remain undefeated in Big East play for two straight years and take a step closer to the top seed. Notre Dame and Kevin Corrigan have a road game on Friday night at Chapel Hill on ESPNU. Joel White and his class pick up another win. And once again, our final score from the Carrier Dome, Syracuse 11, Notre Dame 8. Coming up next, the Sector Spiders lacrosse season update show. The largest on-campus crowd in Division I college lacrosse this season sees number one Notre Dame lose for the first time all season, and Syracuse picks up career season win number 13. Now let's join Rob Simulcare in the studio.